video?
You now are.
Okay, so we'll have to continue this discussion later. Okay, does anybody have any questions?
So,
yeah.
What makes something expensive?
Explosive?
Expensive.
One is the energy content. Okay, expensive is also a relative thing. I mean, you know, for some people, a $500 watch is expensive. I mean, you can buy a watch for $10, right? You can buy a watch, you know, and I wear Seiko for, I get for $150 at Costco, okay? You can buy one for $500 at Costco, and they might consider that an expensive watch. You can start putting diamonds on it, and then you can start having a name, which has no functional value, it's all pride, and that could cost $50,000. So at the lower end of the material scale, when we're talking about steel and aluminum and copper, it's the energy content. We talked about that. I mean, I said, you know, it used to be labor and then materials, but today it's materials and energy. The labor cost has sort of gone out of these things, okay, in the last 50 years. I mean, you're seeing a revolution right now that's equal to the industrial revolution of 150 years ago, okay, in manufacturing productivity, okay. I'm going to put up a slide today that 1990 steel was 1 hour per ton, one person hour per ton. Well, today it's 0.3. You know, so in 25 years, it's improved by a factor of three. But then we've talked about, so energy cost is one thing. Once you get there, now if you want to go to the really high value added materials, fancy composites and stuff, it's all processing. I mean, I kind of said, well, you know, for a pipeline, 30% of the cost of a pipeline is the metal that goes into it. And the rest of it's digging the hole in the ground, the inspection, and, you know, right-of-ways and things like that. For an automobile, it's 90% is the processing cost. It's a more complex product. If you go to an aircraft or a spacecraft or something, you're getting to the point where 98-99% of the cost is all the processing and manufacturing, machining and joining and inspection and everything else. So you really, you really have to talk about the market you're in. Are you down here in the ships and automobiles where we're talking about less than $2 a pound fabricated? Okay. Are we talking about the $20,000 a pound spacecraft? Okay. That's kind of where I was going with the watches. I mean, you can have $50,000 watches, you can have $10 watches. So what makes something expensive in different industries really depends on which industry. The lower end industries, it's mostly energy today. The higher end, it's all engineering, design, you know, marketing. I mean, what makes beer expensive? It's all the ads on TV and other places. I mean, when I worked in, my first big consulting job was in a brewery in upstate New York. And at that time, it cost them, as I remember, 13 cents a gallon to make beer. But they weren't ever selling it, even in 1975, for 13 cents a gallon. There's a big markup, okay? I don't know, today beer might cost 50 or 60 cents a gallon to make. But they get a big markup because there's an awful lot of advertising in that. I'll give you, oops, did I? Maybe I didn't. Maybe I put them back somewhere else. I had my scissors here. I showed you, oh, here they are. So here are my surgical scissors. Okay, what makes these expensive? Well, they're just stainless steel scissors. And you could buy stainless steel scissors for 20 bucks. 25 years ago, these cost 300. They're probably 700 or 800 now. Why? Because you're buying about $500 worth of medical malpractice insurance along with them. The big cost is medical, the application it goes into. So again, the answer is it depends on the industry. Other questions? Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
There is no simple answer.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. Let's just talk about, so last time the theme was productivity is nearly everything if you want to live well in a nation. In the steel industry, the productivity since the time of Henry Bessemer has all been in melting and casting technology. And we've had tremendous growth over the last 170 years in that. And I was giving you some examples of Chaparral steel. And here's an example. Let's see if that's not what I wanted to do. Let's see if I can, I don't want to hit exit because it's liable to kill me. Okay, fine. Okay, so here's the ingot that comes off the continuous caster at Chaparral Steel back in the, I don't know, time frame of 1995 or maybe early 90s. They used to get a rectangular ingot, but then they changed their molds and they would get something that starts to begin to look like an I-beam. Okay? Within about 5 years, and they, actually here's just another picture of a bunch of them. They cut them to length. Here's a strand coming off the continuous caster in the background. It's just have been cut. Within about 5 years, they perfected that some. Let's see if we can get... This one's pretty dark. Get the right angle. Oh, here we go. Okay, here's a little bit. I'm going to have... Gordon Ford gave me these about 20 years ago. Here's the continuous cast part now. It actually does look like an I-beam, right? You can see the end of it there? Okay. And someone says, well, is the quality as good? Well, it turns out, and these are slides from almost 15 years ago, Chaparral Steel, when we were doing the evaluation of them, 1990, one person hour per ton, net shape casting of structural beams drove down the cost by one third. As Gordon Ford used to say, he didn't care if the Japanese or the Koreans or the Chinese were paying their employees nothing. Okay, everybody says, so it's low cost, the advantage of low cost labor. He says, it costs about $50 a ton to ship the product across the ocean. And he was here in the market. The United States is sort of the world's market. Everybody wants to dump their product in the United States because we consume so much of everything. So he said, if he could if he could make his steel within $50, okay, excluding labor, of the cost that they were making it, and it's raw materials and energy cost, then he could beat them in the marketplace, no matter if they, even if they pay people nothing. So if he could drive his cost down, well, he drove the cost down by a third, and by going net shape manufacturing. And it turns out there's been a competition. I talked about plastic water bottles and you know, aluminum bottles, cans, and things like that. Well, there's a competition between steel and concrete. I mean, concrete still has steel in it. Here's a reinforcing bar, if you want to pass it around. It's galvanized, but anyway, I did have one in my office. We talked about reinforcing bar, and you know, they were going slower to roll four times as much, which, you know, if you went half the speed but you rolled four strands rather than one, then you just doubled your productivity on the rolling mill. Okay, well, concrete and steel compete for buildings. If you go around the country and look at parking garages, is the example I like to give. You can look at parking garages and see if they're made out of steel or if they're made out of concrete. And if you know anything about the relative costs at different points in time of reinforced concrete structures versus steel frame structures, you can almost pinpoint within about a one-decade period when that parking garage was built, just on straight economics of which one was more competitive at the time. Okay? I talked about forced end rebar rolling. They had a new facility that was going to drop things. This is like a 1995 slide. And they had $450,000 sales per employee. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, that's one of the metrics that I used to use 20 years ago. If you look at manufacturing companies, you'll find that most of them today have sales per employee in the $150,000 to $200,000 per year range. And if you think about it, you'd better sell $200,000 worth of product in order to pay employees $100,000 a year, because with overhead and everything else, it's $130,000, and that only leaves you $70,000 to buy the materials and other stuff. So to me, when I would look at a company, I would just, you know, if I looked at a balance sheet, I would say, okay, what are their gross sales? Divide by the number of employees, see what the sales are per employee. Back when this slide was, when I made this slide, typical value was like $100,000 of an employee. And you know, so $450,000 per employee of sales is pretty good. I mean, you're way out there on the bell curve, and you can be profitable at that rate. Well, it turns out I had a student back in the 90s working at Boeing at the Door Product Center. Okay, this is where it's a completely deterministic manufacturing business. It takes three years to deliver an airplane, from laying the keel beam to flying it away. And it turns out that the Door Product Center, it takes them about 1 year to produce the doors that go in the fuselage. You know, you walk through the door when you get on an airplane, right? And it turns out they know exactly how many doors they have to produce, because they know they got these airplanes up in the Everett facility or wherever that are being, the fuselages are being built, and they know how many doors, and there's exit doors, there's cargo doors, so you have doors that are not much bigger than someone to crawl through, you have a door someone can walk through, and you have things they can take pallets, and you know, like a double garage door or something, and big 747s and stuff. So there's all kinds of doors, but they have a Door Product Center in south of Seattle, I think it's in Tacoma, whatever, wherever it is. And so I asked him, I said, I was getting a tour of the plant, and I said, well, how much does a door cost? The guy said, well, I don't know, because it's all internal sales, okay? I mean, they only sell to Boeing, right, at the Door Product Center. And they know exactly how many they have to sell that year. And I said, well, how many employees do you have? He says, 750. I said, let's see if I get this right. He says, 200. Yeah, 750 employees. I said, how many doors do you make a year? He says, about 250. I said, oh, well, did I get this right? Yeah. I said, then your average door costs about $50,000. Because at that time, I was figuring Boeing's a little bit better, maybe $150,000 sales per employee. Okay? And he said, well, I don't know if that's true or not. So a little bit later, I asked his boss, His boss, and I told him how I estimated it, about $50,000 a door. So that door you walk through is about a $50,000 door. Now today it's probably $100,000 because that was almost 20 years ago. But nonetheless, that, you know, that's one way to estimate things on a very high level. And it's actually pretty accurate. His boss actually says, yeah, well, that's probably about right. But they didn't even know. I mean, the accountants hadn't figured out for them what it cost to make a door. But I can tell you, they had to put a drill by hand for every rivet hole in that door. A mechanic, and these mechanics are making about 40 or 50 bucks an hour at Boeing, okay? Actually, today, they're probably making 60 or 70. And with the Boeing overhead, that means like 150 bucks an hour, you know, for their cost and stuff. A mechanic has to take a drill and put it through that hole about four times. You have to rough drill the hole, you have to size the hole, you have to ream the hole. And there were, I mean, I can't even remember all the things they had to do, but for every hole, they had to put a different drill through about four times. And there's lots of rivets on the door. So you start looking at this and you find, So what's expensive? Well, I think, you know, compared to my door in my home, that's an expensive door, but there's a lot more labor goes in that aircraft door, okay? Okay, this is another thing we can pass around. I talked about transformation of steel to martensite, austenitic steel to martensite. This is a Faberware part, one of the other lectures that's online. I'll tell the whole story, but you can feel by taking this neodymium magnet, almost non-magnetic down here, and you get up to the top, gets very magnetic. It's got cracks in it. These are hydrogen cracks because it transformed to the type of steel that's susceptible to hydrogen cracking. Okay, so that's four strand rebar rolling. And stuff. The other slide that goes to the chaparral. Rolled steel beams. They had 41% imports to the U.S. prior to their new mill in the mid-90s. Currently, at that time, chaparral, they had dropped the imports to the United States to zero because they could beat them in the marketplace. And they exported 20% of the product outside North America. So the new wide flange mill, because you're starting out with the net shape casting, 75% energy savings, inline reheat. It comes out, it used to be in the steel mills, you know, you'd have this continuous caster and you'd have this red hot band of steel that you take an oxygen jet and you flame cut it with pure oxygen because it's already hot enough to oxidize, and then you let it sit down in there and cool. Well, people said that's silly to let all that waste energy. So they basically now have things that it goes directly from the casting machine into a reheat furnace to get it uniform in temperature, and then it goes directly into the rolling mill. So there's not standing aside and reheating. So 28 minutes total. I mean, the processing time goes from days down to 28 minutes. You end up, because you're doing all this stuff faster and whatnot, and it essentially you can do it at lower temperature, or you can roll at lower temperature, the steel at lower temperatures. You get finer grain, all chill cast, higher tensile and toughness. And it turns out, if you're a civil engineer, they used to make most of the steel, bridges and buildings and stuff, was 36 KSI yield, A36 steel. A higher grade was 50 KSI. Turns out, with the fine grain size and the good toughness, because fine grain size gives you both strength and toughness, they were actually rolling compositions that was A36 composition, but they get 50 KSI yield. And so they didn't have to inventory the product. By 1995 or 1998, you order A36 from Chaparral, they'd ship you out of this pile. You order 50 KSI, they'd ship you out of the same pile. Had both of them had equivalent weldability, just as easy to weld as the lower strength A36, but you could get 50 KSI, and if you were smart enough, you could order 36 KSI and get 50 KSI for free. Okay? They would get 50 KSI as a premium. Actually, you couldn't do that because you have to have certifications for the building people and everything else that all meets that. But in fact, they got to the point where it was just as easy to make 50 KSI material as it was to make 36 KSI material. And the toughness was off the charts. Yep.
Who was the guy that was behind all of this? You say there was a
Well, actually, that's another story in and of itself. Gordon Forward was MIT PhD, went off to work for, he's a Canadian, I think he was working for a Canadian steel company, one of the big ones, Stelco or DeFasco. And he and other people kind of looked at it, and I told you the story. You could buy scrap iron for $100 a ton, but it cost you $200 a ton to make cast iron. And if you went the electric furnace route as opposed to the basic oxygen furnace to melt your steel, basic oxygen furnace required 70% virgin iron ore blast furnace, you know, iron blast furnace type of hot melt. Electric furnace, you could take all scrap and you could melt it. But you'd always have impurities, residual elements, and people thought, well, you could never make anything better than rebar. So back in the early 70s, you know, people like Bethlehem Steel, when I was working for them, you know, that's garbage for a variety of stuff. We don't want that. It's low premium, low markup. And then they learned, but Gordon Forward and Ken Iverson was the guy who started a company called Nucor Steel, which became the biggest of the mini mills. And it wasn't just one mill. We did build new steel mills after Bethlehem Steel's Burns Harbor plant, which was built in 1965. But by the 1970s, not the steel companies, but people like Ken Iverson, who started out in a strip mall in Charlotte, North Carolina, okay, to build a steel mill in South Carolina, just over the border. And Gordon Forward, who found some investors, they built a mini mill in Midlothian, Texas, okay, just outside of Dallas. They built mini mills that had 1/20th the capacity. They just had a big electric furnace, and at that time electric furnaces could only melt 50 ton heats. Well, those same electric furnaces, they're up to like 165 ton heats. They're almost as big as the BOF shops. It'll cost you $1 billion, and these guys were paying, you know, $25 million or $50 million for an electric furnace shop. And they just kept on, they started water cooling everything and putting in bigger transformers, and just, they could melt steel just almost as fast as the big guys in their $1 billion facility, but they were doing it with a $50 or $100 million facility, okay? Tremendous capital gain savings, or capital cost savings. So, but they also had a different philosophy. I wouldn't plan on spending this much time on steel. Steve Wheelwright and I went down there, and we were doing this evaluation of why good product development and bad product development at different companies. And we were doing Chaparral, and they had some failures. I won't go through those. But on the first day, I said, well, they were telling us about one of the failures. I said, well, who gets the blame? And the people acted like, what do you mean blame? And I didn't realize until the second day, you don't get blamed if you try something different at Chaparral. You get blamed if you don't try something new. Okay? So there is blame, but the blame is not for trying something different and failing. It's for not doing something new this year. If you just keep doing the same old thing at Chaparral, you're a loser. Also, if you go into every one of those shops, on the bulletin board, they will have the weekly profit of the company. And it's a profit-sharing company. Every employee there could tell you exactly how much money they made the week before, because they posted the weekly profits, and they knew how many shares they had. Okay? So the people had an incentive. And, you know, they would jury rig things and figure out cheaper way to do things. So it wasn't Gordon Forward. It was the culture that Gordon Forward put forward. I mean, put forward, yeah, Gordon Forward. But anyway, at Bethlehem Steel, at the Taj Mahal Research Labs that we had, they had an executive dining room. I told you about the strawberries, the size of, you know, bigger than golf balls, that I had never seen in 1975. Yeah, you can get them now, but I could never seen them before. And you weren't allowed in the executive dining room. We had a beautiful dining room, looked over the mountain, you know, and everything, but it wasn't as nice as the executive dining room. There's great stories about these Taj Mahal dining rooms. I mean, there's a story about Lee Iacocca wanted to know once, when he was president of Ford, why one of the Fords, chairman of the company, I don't remember which Ford it was at the time, said, he was saying he loved hamburgers. And he said, I never get any hamburger as good as the one here at the Ford Executive Dining Room. So Laiakoka goes in to see the chef. He says, so why are your hamburgers so good? And he says, I'll show you. And he goes and he gets a sirloin steak out of the freezer, prime, puts it in the grinder, and said, here. So, hey, Henry Ford can afford it. Anyway, so at Chaparral, the executive dining, as Gordon Ford used to call it, the executive dining room was a folding table, and they would bring in barbecue, and we ate with plastic knives and forks out of foam containers. That was the executive dining room at Chaparral, as opposed to Bethlehem or Ford Motor Company or Kodak or all these other places where they treated the managers like royalty. At Chaparral, everyone was equal. And if you go back and read my leadership management and education article at MIT, there's actually that same theme in there, okay, about, you know, leadership is treating people equally, and my little soundbite is leaders seek to help others, managers seek to control others. So at Bethlehem Steel, they just wanted to control others. I mean, at Bethlehem Steel, we had a manual that thick that told me who I could write a letter to within the company, okay? I could write one level up or one level down within my own research organization, or I could write at the same level to some person in another organization at Bethlehem Steel. But the manual was that thick on who I could write a letter to, okay? And they had rules about who could have carpeting on the floor, who could have drapes on the windows. So one of my colleagues in his office was looking at x-rays, and he took some black cloth and he covered up the light from the windows. And about a month later, some manager came by, saw the cloth on the window, says, what gives you the right to have the drapes? Okay? Well, that's what the managers were worried about. You know, this guy had drapes and he was just an engineer. Okay? It's a good thing he didn't put a towel to mop up something on the floor. They'd say, anyway, so this is one of the reasons I work at a university. Not that we don't have the same type of stupid administrative bureaucracy, but with tenure, you can thumb your nose at them, okay? But you gotta get tenure first, okay? But I got it, so I can. Anyway, okay, so that's all on steel. Anybody have any questions? I didn't plan on going through that, but hey, anybody have another question? Okay, so what I had planned on doing today was take another industry and just show you that I'm not negative about everything. I want to talk about glass technology. I haven't told you, I've told you all the bad things about glass. It's brittle, it's not a structural material, but in fact, it is a structural material. And it has a history. If you go to the web, you can read about Sugar Hollow Glass Company, and they make nice artistic glass. They will actually sell you what's called bullseye glass. Anybody know what bullseye glass is? Yeah, that's it right there. What? No, you mean this little thing in the corner? That's right. And there's a history of bullseye glass in the United States. Remember no taxation without representation type stuff, you know, and things the British were trying to tax us. Well, glass used to be a very labor-intensive industry because the way they made glass, at least into the 18th century in England, was to, just like we do down in the glass lab, you take a blowpipe, just a steel tube, you take some glass out of the furnace and stick it on there, and you get it to the right temperature, and you blow through the pipe, and you blow up and make a little glass beaker or whatever. You can shape it, you can form it. Eventually, you can cut a hole in it and keep on spinning it in the furnace, and you can make a disc of glass. And if you make that disc of glass, if you're clever about it, thought I had a picture. I did have a picture. Except that's not the picture. If you're clever about it, you can make relatively flat squares, rectangles of glass, not very big. I don't see it right now. I'll come across it later. But at the center of this thing, you're going to end up with something that's got all kinds of distortion and stuff. You actually break it off the blowpipe by putting a little, taking a little file, go down there and watch it in the glass lab. You put a little file mark on it, and then you kind of hit it quickly, and it breaks off, and you end up with a piece of bullseye glass. And people would put this over the lintels of the doors, okay? And the reason they would do it is because glass was expensive. People didn't have electric lights back in the 18th century. People wanted some light in their house, so over the door, they would put glass to let the light in. But bullseye glass didn't have a tax because it was considered scrap. It distorted everything, but what do you care? You just want light to come through. You're not trying to look out the window here. Now, looking out the window required one of the pieces of flat glass that was taxed, and people didn't put a lot of windows in their houses because they were drafty and they also cost a lot of money. Yep.
They cast the flat glass.
I'm going to talk about that. Okay. So this is the way they made glass. They just blow it, make a big circle, cut rectangles out of a circle, throw away the center. And so the cheapest stuff was the bullseye glass. However, if you go to, I got things out of order somewhere here. If you go today and you go to Sleepy Hollow Glass, they'll sell you one of these little bullseye things, 6 inches square for $55, okay? Or 8 inches square for like $90. Well, that's pretty pricey, but now it's art, okay? People put this over the doors of their home still so they can look like they're an 200-year-old home or something, right? Be careful of the sharp edges, so that's why you keep it up top. Anyway, so plate glass manufacture, on the other hand, which is what you were asking about, was invented about 1688 by Abraham Thivart. And that became the Saint-Gobain Company. Anybody ever heard of Saint-Gobain? Saint-Gobain's got a lot of contacts with us, with this department, in part because one of my former doctoral students, Rakesh Kapoor, was head of their research center here in Northboro, and he started, you know, the Mad Mech and all this other stuff. They fund those things. But Saint-Gobain in 1688, this guy, Abraham Thivart, learned to pour glass onto a metal table, spreading it with rollers, annealing, grinding, and polishing. Okay? That was the beginning of Saint-Gobain. If you want to see a picture, probably from the 19th century, here's a picture of making plate glass. You start with a metal glass. You pour it on a slightly inclined table. That was an invention in the 1800s to use an inclined table, and here's your steel roll, and they're going to take this molten stuff and they're just going to roll it out flat. Okay? Problem is, there are inhomogeneities in the glass, and that type of plate glass, unless you ground it and polished it, and even if you did grind it and polish it, still had a lot of distortion. Okay? And this is a window, an old window in Jena, Germany. And here's a piece of modern glass, which is not plate glass. It's actually what we call float glass. I'm going to talk about that. And you can see the reflection of a tree in that glass. Here is some of the old plate glass in the rest of this window. And you can sort of see the black outlines of the tree, but it's sort of been distorted, right? Okay? In there. But someone broke the glass up here and they had to replace it. Yep. Steel and glass don't like each other. It'll come off anyway. Plus, as it cools down, thermal expansion causes them to separate at the interface. But it's a problem to try to bond glass to steel. We can do it, but we have to put an inner layer like titanium or something reactive in there. Okay? So far as that goes. So, in any case, still haven't found my other slides of some of these things. But continuous ribbon production. So plate glass, they would roll it out on these big plates. And a company like, you ever heard of Pittsburgh Plate Glass? PPG, okay, is what they're called now. They had them, I'm told, or I've read, around the turn of the beginning of the 20th century, in the early 1900s. They had a facility in Pittsburgh that was a mile-long building, nice and straight. At one end, they would cast the plate glass, and they would move it straight, no turning or anything, because glass is brittle, and they would grind it and polish it to where it was fairly smooth. And that's what we call plate glass. And typically it might be half an inch thick or even thicker. We call it plate glass because it's thick, because hey, you roll it out, and if you make it too thin, you have these great big sheets of it, you're gonna break them. So it tends to be thicker. So you ever heard of Libby Owens Ford? Okay, glass. Used to have a little LOF on most of the Ford cars. It turns out continuous ribbon production of glass was invented at the Ford Motor Company in 1920. And by 1926, the production was achieved by flowing glass from a tank furnace over a weir. A weir is just a little ceramic brickwork, just like going over a waterfall. This is a controlled waterfall. You just have this thick, viscous glass going over the weir, and you pull it over that weir onto a table and let it cool. And then you do the plate glass process. Hey, why did Henry Ford need that? Because he was making lots of windshields for Model Ts and Model As and whatnot. Pilkington Brothers put that into production, and they developed a continuous grinding and polishing process by 1925. However, I don't know exactly when, but by probably the 1940s, Pilkington developed their own process called the Pilkington process, which is the float glass process. And basically you have a blending and melting furnace. So this is called the batch house. And then the furnace, which you melt it. And let me tell you, you go through one of these plants, and I have been through a float glass plant in Ohio. And you're walking by this furnace at 1550°C, that's about half the size of a football field, and it's hot, okay? A lot of radiant heat, even though it's insulated and everything. Anyway, they pull it over the weir, and then they float it on a bath of molten tin. Here's the molten tin bath, okay? Not a very deep bath of molten tin, probably only a couple of inches, but it's probably 15 feet wide. And now you can pull off stuff that's an eighth of an inch thick, 3/16, quarter of an inch thick, okay? And you take that and you anneal it, because glass can have serious problems if it's got residual stresses in it, and you cut it to size and you ship it, okay? It's not a mile long building. It might be a couple hundred yards, but it's not a mile, okay? Now, in these furnaces, by the way, yeah? Well, the inhomogeneities originally came from, they were just taking the sand and the limestone and all these different components, they were putting it into a furnace. It was in the 1800s that they learned to stir the bath, okay? Glass is very thick, okay, very viscous. And the reason that Jena window, a lot of those inhomogeneities were not surface irregularities, they were chemical. Inhomogeneities.
So it's possible to have plate glass manufacturing, but without inhomogeneities.
Since the last 200 years, yeah. But I mean, if you go back, that's why they had to go to Jena, Germany to find that window, okay? Because that's 200-year-old technology. Okay. It was, in fact, if I look at my little history of plate glass, he says in 1884 to 87, the mechanical stirring of molten glass was not introduced until 1798 by Gunand and was perfected in 1805. It turns out France kept this as a trade secret. The British didn't get it until about their late 1700s, early 1800s. So the first 100 years, France sort of controlled the world's glass manufacturing. And it was mostly for mirrors, okay? And in fact, Saint-Gobain made all the windows and mirrors in the Versailles Palace. If you actually look up Saint-Gobain, you'll find they're very proud of the fact that they go back to Versailles, okay? They had the technology to make big glass plates. The British didn't for 100 years. But the British learned to stir the bath, okay, and get more uniform mixtures. Then Pittsburgh plate glass comes along. Mile-long building, very expensive, lots of hand labor, grinding and polishing. And then Pilkington comes along in the night after World War II, comes up with the float glass process, and that's actually plate glass, probably if it's the original things from this building. But if it's not original, if it's been replaced, broken and replaced, which is fair chance that it was, it's going to be float glass. Float glass, you know, I don't know that you see half-inch thick float glass. So plate glass processing is still around. The float glass process, you want to keep it relatively thin so you know, move stuff across that bath fairly quickly. Most of these glasses are what we call soda-lime glasses, meaning they're made with sodium oxide, calcium oxide, and of course all glass has SiO2 in it. Some of it has some Al2O3, but you see calcium limestone and sodium, so you see 74%, 11%, and 12%. Most of this is sodium soda-lime glass, okay? And that's float glass for windows, okay? If you go to borosilicate glasses, you can drop the temperature considerably by adding borax, 6%. It has more alumina in it, it has more MgO in it, and this could be made into textile fibers, fiberglass. Why do you like to use borosilicate? It drops the melting temperature several hundred degrees, and therefore spinning the fibers is a lot easier at lower temperatures, okay? If I go look at other glasses and their compositions, TV panel glass composition, okay? 72% silica, so high silica, some barium, some strontium, okay? Some potassium. Some of these things actually start adding the right transmissivity. You don't have some color to the glass. You may not notice the color to that glass, but if you did a spectral analysis, you find that it's not letting all the wavelengths through equally. On a TV, you'd like to have something a little better. And let's see what else we've got. Fiber wool, borosilicate glass. Okay, so we're still making fibers. Typically, there's lots of different glass compositions. Structural glasses are tens of millions of tons a year. Okay? Not as big as aluminum, but we use glass in a number of applications in buildings like the Versailles Palace, or you look at the PPG building, it has lots of windows, probably plate glass type windows, but anyway, PPG's doing the float glass now. But yeah. I don't know if Fraunhofer, I thought Fraunhofer was a bunch of physicists who were looking at Fraunhofer diffraction and things like that. Is there a Fraunhofer? There's some great glassworks in Europe, like Swarovski, you know, and Schott Glass, S-C-H-O-T-T.
I think Fraunhofer, from a while back, he did a lot of creative ways to make the optical glass so good that you could do a lot of...
Oh, okay. There is a whole... Yeah, you're right. Okay. Fraunhofer was looking at optics, okay, and improving optics. I'm sort of talking about structural glass. There is a whole different thing of what they call crown glass, which is making optical glass. I mean, yeah, we had glass for years. I mean, who was it? Who was the guy who made the first lens glass eyeglasses? It was like the 1600s. I can't remember who it was. But anyway, wasn't Leeuwenhoek, was it? Leeuwenhoek, okay. I knew it began with L, but I was about to give someone else's name. But anyway, so there's a whole group of people who are making small little discs for eyeglasses. They weren't interested in something like, you know, the bullseye glass or the spun glass. They were making little glasses and polishing them, and they were mixing and getting homogeneity. They couldn't tolerate any inhomogeneity that would change the index of refraction, because then you'd be looking through a Coke bottle, you know, literally, when it wasn't a prescription Coke bottle, right? So, but there are some very high value-added glasses. Turns out Corning, which used to have some very close ties to this department, but has even closer ties to Alfred University, which is the New York State College of Ceramics, which has a very good glass, the best glass technology program. But one is, well, Corning had a whole business in television sets. I mean, you had the old cathode ray tubes making this blown glass with a slightly curved surface into a steel mold was a technology that Corning perfected the technology of blowing that glass into a mold and doing it cheaper, more uniformly than anyone else in the world. And Corning is sort of a trade secret company. They don't patent a lot, they just make it. And I can't think of any other company I've ever been in where it was harder to get through the door than the security at Corning, okay? And not only in terms of signing non-disclosures, but, you know, you can't bring a camera, you can't, you know, if you needed pictures, they would take the pictures, they would review the pictures, and then they would send you the pictures, you know, afterwards and stuff. But, so Corning had this huge business in the 1970s in two products. One was light bulbs, which is just a little blown glass, you know, incandescent light bulbs. And the other was TV tubes. Well, they were losing the TV tube business when plasma displays started coming around in the 80s and stuff. And then LEDs and liquid crystal displays and everything. So it turns out a liquid crystal display is actually a composite of glass. And it's got a number of layers. This is right off Wikipedia, but layer one is not glass, it's actually a polarizing filter film, so it's plastic, to polarize the light, because this is going to be a liquid crystal display. And then you've got a glass substrate, which is two, which has got indium tin oxide on it. Why indium tin oxide? It's conductive and transparent. A very interesting set of properties. Most things that are conductive will absorb electrons, and therefore no light. They're impervious to light, like metals. You've never seen only on Star Trek do we have transparent aluminum. Okay? There are no transparent metals, almost by definition. But so they have glass here, and then they have another layer, which is the liquid crystal, twisted pneumatic liquid crystal. Then you have another glass substrate, number four, so two and four are glass substrates. And five is another polarizing plastic filter. And six is a reflective back surface or a light surface if you're doing transmissive light backlit display. Okay? Well, this isn't very thick. Well, it turns out you've got to make glass. Right now, if you go to the Corning website, you'll find that they will make glass for you that is 0.3 millimeters, 12 thousandths of an inch thick, and you can buy it from them in sizes of 1.5 meters by 1.8 meters. So if you want to have a big TV screen, but it's only 12 thousandths thick, be careful how you hold this, okay? Because it's brittle. Believe me, it's brittle. If you go to the Corning website for slim glass and the product information sheet, this is now a big business, and it's a proprietary business for them. So it's alkaline earth boro-aluminosilicate, just like the others, except it's the way you make it, okay? It's a fusion drawn down sheet. Now, even the melting furnaces are sort of interesting here, because you put the cullet in, and you melt it, and you hold it, and then you draw it out of the furnace, but the parts that have to be ductile, like the tubes and the nozzle, they're all made out of platinum. So a typical melting furnace at Corning could have $10 million worth of platinum in it. Yeah?
Where did the micro cracks and the very smooth glass plate come from, so you can just break it with your hands, for instance?
Oh, well, I'm going to talk about that. So hold on just a little bit, okay? In fact, the next sheet of this. And it goes through and gives you properties, mechanical, gives you density, gives you modulus, gives you shear modulus, Poisson's ratio of hardness. Didn't give you tensile strength, did it? It didn't give you bending strength. Well, hey, if it's only 12,000 thick, it does have a little bending strength, just don't twist it too much, okay? But thermal expansion, thermal conductivity, optical loss, and all this other stuff. Now, to answer your question, then comes chemical resistance. Well, everybody knows, hey, you use glassware for the lab, chemistry lab. Weathering. Weathering is defined as corrosion. Glass doesn't corrode, does it? Okay. Corrosion by atmospheric-borne gases and vapor, such as water and carbon dioxide. Glass is corroded by water vapor. You didn't know that, did you? Glass is rated 1, will almost never show weathering effects. Those rated 2 will occasionally be troublesome, and those require more careful consideration and durability. Okay, so So how do we prove this? Well, if I pull a glass fiber, brand new glass fiber, aluminum borosilicate glass, and I'm going to make it into fiberglass with the best strength. And you can buy this from Corning. It's called E-glass, or they had different letters and different compositions. I had better coat that with the epoxy within 24 hours because the humidity in the air is going to degrade the strength. When I pull it and measure the strength right away as fresh new surface of that fiber, it may have 600,000-700,000 pounds per square inch tensile strength. An hour later, it may be 500,000 pounds per square inch tensile strength. The next day, it may be 400,000. A month later, it's going to be a piece of glass. I mean, it is a piece of glass, but it'll be so brittle that you want to use it as a strengthening element in fiberglass. So when you make fiberglass, you go and you get it epoxy coated real quick to protect it from the moisture in the air. On the ligands, on the end of this, you've got these silica tetrahedra, and then you got sodium, and the sodium wants to form sodium hydroxides. It'll form silicon hydroxides, okay? And those things will actually form little etch pits of the glass. Microscopic, you can't see them, but if you go through the fracture toughness of this glass, go back to the Ashby plot and look where the glasses are in terms of fracture toughness and calculate the minimum flaw size. Remember, it's like 10 to the minus 4 millimeters? We're talking angstroms of critical flaw size, or tens of angstroms. So you don't have to have very much corrosion where you're basically just the humidity in the air. Now, I've never seen this, but my thesis advisor told me, Bob Rose, he still lives up on the North Shore, and Sylvania up in Danvers has a glass manufacturing plant, or a light bulb manufacturing. It's part of their lighting division, and they used to make light bulbs. I'm sure they had licensed the Corning technology. Bob would stop by before he would lecture 3091 and pick up some freshly made light bulbs. And he'd bring them into class, and an hour later, he would throw them against the wall, and they'd just bounce off the wall. Try that the next day, okay? And they'd shatter. Well, he didn't do it the next day. But freshly made glass is extremely strong because it has no surface flaws, because it hasn't corroded, hasn't been corroded by the moisture in the air yet. Does that answer your question? Okay. So glass is a structural material if you protect it from the corrosion of moisture in the air. But most places have a lot of moist air. Not Arizona, except when it rains, they have monsoons. How much time do we have left? Yes. Yeah.
Something like that. Does that change then over time?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so when they quote you, like, this is only like an additional content, you assume that it's going to get more over
the course of the lecture. Yeah, I'm going to, the next lecture I give is on Tuesday, and I didn't get all the way through the glass stuff. I had thought about this morning, if you want to go and go to YouTube or Corning, and they have some videos on making optical glass fibers. I decided optical glass fibers aren't a structural material. But it's a wonderful story. They take silicon tetrachloride gas because it's so pure, and they flame spray a starting rod, and they build up something that's like an inch or two in diameter. And they grade the composition as they do it, so they get a graded index of refraction. And then they draw, it's called drawing the glass. Okay, and they take this can't remember what they call the precursor, and they just draw miles and miles of optical fiber. So what was your question? I'm sorry.
So the water content.
The water content. In that, they actually have a drying step before they do everything. They have to dry it in an oven to get the moisture out. I knew there was a reason. I was sorry, I couldn't remember what it was. But no, they have to dry the glass can pick up moisture, sodium hydroxide, or a silicon hydroxide, or sodium hydroxide, or potassium hydroxide. You can get OH ions in there, and it will screw up some of the optical qualities of optical glass. Okay? So, if you want to learn more about glass, is an interesting, very interesting material. Corning really owns the technology in the world. They hold it as a trade secret. Okay? And although they've hired a lot of ceramists out of MIT who've risen very high in the corporation, it's a very inbred corporation. And after they spend enough time in Corning, New York, they usually prefer to go to Alfred University. We don't even have a glass person in the department anymore, okay? The last real glass person we had was Don Ullman. He went to Arizona to retire. So, okay, thanks. I'll see you. Simone will be here in the next 2 days. I'll be here on Tuesday, and I'll start talking to you more about the